was a Friday afternoon some years ago when I was struck by lightning leaving my classroom. I was looking at the board of the purpose and playlist I had written up, like I do at the end of each day to prepare for tomorrow's lesson. The purpose was for students to understand three ways that heat is transferred, and I prepared my playlist with the activities to teach this important concept in thermodynamics. My classroom, however, is a curious thing. I leave clues all over the place to help students make connections on their own and discover the science for themselves. That leads to anticipation, hidden in the weekly calendar with sketches and puns. There's often a code in the daily agenda. So for Monday's lesson, after the routine warm-up track, I simply wrote CCR. And then, with my bike helmet buckled, I pushed my bike past the whiteboard heading for the door, when lightning hit me. CCR! Of course! I'm Jessica Levine, and I teach sixth grade science in one of Seattle's largest public middle schools. I've been teaching physical science for 15 years, drawing on my background of biology, chemistry, and environmental studies. I love this quote by Frank Oppenheimer. He says, "Art and science are very different, but they both spring from cultivated perceptual sensitivity. They both rest on a basis of acute pattern recognition. At the simplest level, artists and scientists alike make it possible for people to appreciate patterns which they were either unable to distinguish or which they had learned to ignore in order to cope with the complexity of their daily lives." I like the connection of art and science. My mother was into community theater, and my father is a dentist. I literally danced my way through my biology degree at a college also known for its conservatory of music. So teaching is the most creative thing I can do. And I use music in my classroom in a number of ways. A playlist helps students know the activities of the day. It's the playlists that are the things that we'll do in a class period to meet the purpose. Some educators would call it an agenda. But by calling it a playlist, it means that sometimes we might shuffle it in order to get the best experience due to time, talent, or conversation. Also, the entire playlist helps create the day's theme, and I let students regularly know that I've carefully curated it. I'm like a DJ. I'm choosing these things for them to engage their learning. I also use music now in transitions for both classroom management and time efficiency. It started years back when I asked students to shuffle their papers forward with the tune of "Every day I'm shuffling." And now it's an entry song that matches the day of the week. I meet students at the door with high fives every day. And on Monday, I play Tuesday, I play Ruby Tuesday by The Stones, and on Wednesday, and on Thursday, it's a sweet Thursday, and on Friday, I play what's called the Friday song here in Seattle, as dubbed by KEXP DJ John Richards. It's the song Show Me by Mint Royale. All of these daily songs become like musical chairs. When the song stops, students need to be on time with their lab sheets, notebooks, and supplies. It's a great way to manage the classroom. But more importantly, I use music to help make meaning and memory. An intro song can introduce themes or simply help start the day. I began using music to introduce topics years ago. No pressure, mind you, but I bet you can figure out what I taught the day I used these clips. I play the Austin Powers bossa nova beat the day I introduced lava lamps. And I also use music to review concepts, like They Might Be Giants Element song and the Periodic Table song by Tom Lear. There's antimony, arsenic, aluminum, selenium. Middle school students love music. But they also need movement. Kinesthetic movement has been shown to increase muscle memory and memory in general. And in my classroom, this is beyond brain breaks. It's skillfully crafted movements to make meaning of the rigor and content that they're learning in class. Here are two examples. When teaching how to read the graduated cylinder, students need to get down to eye level. So, get down, get down, get That jungle boogie helped kick off the three dance moves, and here's what it looks like. When it came to understanding density, I wanted students to have a muscle memory of division, so I took to disco. And I can tell by the way those particles pop that they're moving things, there's no time to stop. And I can tell if you judge things of the same size, you'll learn a lot, you'll realize that it's all right, it's okay, and you can't look the other way. Because if you try to understand that density can be your friend, hit it!
Mass divided by volume equals density, density. Mass divided by volume equals density, density.
Middle school students are a unique bunch. They're capable of so much content. But while content is ubiquitous, online and with ample videos, it won't stick with students unless it makes sense to them personally. And my role as a middle school science educator is to help make meaning of that content and to show them how it relates to their daily lives. And furthermore, my job is to excite them to want to learn more. That means I must practice more than the three R's. Not just reading, writing, and arithmetic, but relationships, relevance, repetition, retention, and recall. My students marvel at these methods. Here's what they have to say.
Oh, yes, she did a lot of songs that she would play on her ukulele. She taught us a few songs that really helped me, like, remember it, because the tune would always get stuck in my head, and I'd be singing it at night in bed, and I couldn't get it out.
Instead of, let's say, putting together a presentation or a PowerPoint or something, which she also did just as, like, an opening thing, she would make up these funny little songs to help us, like, learn different things. For example, like, Masturbated by Volume.
Levine did a lot of, like, songs about things we were learning, and it kind of helped me, like, memorize things for, like, quizzes or tests, and it helped us learn a lot.
Well, for instance, like, instead of using, like, a passage from a textbook, she'd maybe play a song for us. She could have written it herself, or she could have found it on the internet somewhere.
And also, it was fun.
And she always made it really fun, and while we would work, she would also play some music, and it helped us. At least me, I really liked it when she did it, so, yeah.
So I was creative and musical, sure, before that lightning struck me that day. But that bolt jolted something else altogether. My mother was a master of parody songs. She turned Broadway show tunes into toasts and roasts for family celebrations and holiday history. I had inherited her baritone ukulele and had been learning a few simple chords. But it was that plasma, that lightning bolt, surely a sign from my late mother. It seemed she was passing the gift of parody to me. And it was as if I had written CCR in neon, because it was now energized and kept flashing to me, begging me to write a mom-inspired parody song. I was buzzing. As soon as I locked up the bike at home, I looked at the chords and the lyrics for Clearance Clearwater Revival's Bad Moon Rising. To my delight, it was a simple couple chord song, just a G, a D, and an A minor. I could handle it. So I copied the original lyrics on the left side of a T-chart, and I began to write my parody on the right. The hand jive work that I wanted kids to do was pivotal, and it helped students make meaning. You see, conduction is heat transfer in direct contact with one another. So that would work with a clap of the hands, directly in contact with one another. Convection is where heat transfers through a density-driven currents, and I would find students waving their arms in small circles. That might help make it stick. And radiation is heat transferred through a gas, like a fire or a candle, and then if students twinkled their fingers and wiggled their rays of arms, like rays of sun, their forearms, then we might have something that can stick with them. Why don't you have a listen?
Conduction!
looks like we're in for nasty weather. Losing until equilibrium. Cause it can't get cold tonight. He's bound to leave your life when he transfers on the rise.
Oh, yeah.
It can't get cold tonight. He's bound to leave your life when he transfers on the rise.
Well, we are all at this Voices conference because we know and understand the power of music and song in making meaning for science content. And we know, based on our own interests and our own observations, that we can remember the lyrics of a song we haven't heard in years, just after hearing the melody, or even a few bars. That power of recall through music is huge, and it's an incredibly important part of the learning process. So creating songs for middle school students requires some degree of simplicity so that the recall is not through the weed of words, but it's succinct and clear enough to deliver the meaning and make it stick within like 3 minutes or less of the song. In my classroom, students learn the CCR song so quickly because I start the class with the original Clearance Clearwater Revival song playing as they walk in. It's catchy. It sticks. They can bounce to it. Then, after the lesson on heat transfer, I take out my ukulele and play for them, and they listen with rapt attention. And then I invite them to sing along. And it's that hand jive movement they need to make more meaning. I find that they sing it later when applying their concepts to modeling how an ice cube feels cold in your hand. I can walk around the room with my ukulele, changing the lyrics a bit, singing to them, "Well, you can't get cold tonight. Heat's bound to leave your hand when there's an ice cube in there." And they get it. You might say that that lesson really transferred. Before I close, I want to add a note about relevance and contemporary music. I was proud of the puns of my creation, so I invited the principal into class to witness what I thought was a really great lesson. I mean, it was like a dream Pixar movie, so to speak, with jokes for the adults and laughs for the kids. Really, something for everyone. To my surprise, the principal was not pleased with this kind of outdated song, and he suggested the next time I write a parody, I'd choose something of my students' current generation. Well, I had two thoughts. The next time I write a parody, like that's gonna happen, I was struck by lightning. But of course, I wouldn't be here if it hadn't been true, and I have written many others. And the second thought I had was, wait a minute, Bad Moon Rising is a classic for a reason. It's got musicality that makes things stick. It's simple rhythm. It's a simple chord song. It's got repetition, and it's got recall. Well, to humor him and to try it out with my students, I did add this slide to my CCR lesson. Not sure who it is? It's the boy band One Direction. Because after all, heat travels in just one direction, right? Yeah, my students grown too. And even more so when they thought, when I grabbed the ukulele, that we'd be singing One Direction songs. Which helped me prove my point. That it didn't need to change to a more contemporary song. What I had was working. CCR, to teach CCR, has become a sixth grade science classic. Thanks again for your time and attention, and I look forward to singing with you soon.